of data science, but what we mean by accessibility is how easy it is for visually impaired person to do the task whatever we are talking about. That's what accessibility means in general. Before we get started, we would like to also say that the aim of this talk is to get you excited about the challenges that are there, and maybe let's work together and propose and do some innovative solution that could work for all of us. And before we got started with talks, just do with this introduction. My name is Sunil Chaudhary, and I am currently a working at Morgan Stanley, and I have been doing the programming for last 5 years. And
hi everyone, this is Rishab Jain here. I am currently a student pursuing my integrated master degree in applied mathematics from IIT Roorkee, and I will be joining Microsoft as a data scientist from next year.
So both of us are iSTEM co-founders. iSTEM basically is an organization which empowers people with disabilities, and its aim is to make them technology innovators, not only technology consumers. We do it by various activities. We conduct activities related to research and development in accessibility space. We also do hackathons for accessibility problems, and we work on conducting technical program for visually impaired people as well. So that's about iSTEM hackathon. So let's get started with the main talks. How do you think visually impaired person access the computer? How many do you know that what technology they use? Any ideas? Does anyone know? Yeah, so right. So they use a piece of technology which is called screen reader. And this is a kind of an assistive technology that they use. Now you will be going to hear how does it work. So one of the sample video that you can see how the screen reader works.
You are currently on web content. To enter the web area, press Control Option Shift down arrow. Link like page button. Link pushing love struck cat face. Play video button. You are currently in a group. To exit, link pushing love like page button. Link video Lunar New Year duration 7 seconds. Public button. Like toggle button. You are love toggle button. You are currently on a toggle button inside of a toolbar. To select or deselect this checkbox, press Control Option Space. To navigate items on this toolbar, press Control Option and then up arrow. Ha! Toggle button. Wow! Toggle button.
So what you just heard is a screen reader, which basically was reading out a particular web page. It was telling you what are different controls were there, what you can do with those controls, what buttons can you press. So by using these technology, a visually impaired person is easily able to access the computer. But there are these widely used screen reader, NVDA and JAWS. NVDA is mostly written in Python only and have been developed by mainly visually impaired people or developer themselves. And coming to the topic of the talk, so it is about how a screen reader does read a code, a piece of code. Again, for that, we would like you to experience how does it feel like while listening to the code. So for that, we have a video as well.
Def bubble sort left paren r right paren colon. N equals len left paren r right paren. Blank. For I in range left paren n right paren colon. For j in range left paren 0, n dash I dash 1 right paren colon. If r left bracket j right bracket greater r left bracket j plus 1 right bracket. R left bracket j right bracket, r left bracket j plus 1 right bracket equals r left bracket j plus 1 right bracket, r left bracket j right bracket. Blank. Print left paren quote the sorted array after iteration no quote plus str left paren I plus 1 right paren plus quote colon quote right paren.
So there are a few things to be noticed. You saw that there was a syntax error in the code, but did you feel that screen reader was announcing something special, that hey, you did something wrong? No, unfortunately not. Similarly, you saw that there was a change in indentation level or change in the nesting level, but again, screen reader was not announcing it. All of it was happening in a linear fashion. So that's what the basic problem that underlies readings with screen reader, any kind of piece of code. So So any programmer, when he does coding, so the main thing he looks is what are the different activity that he does, mainly reading, writing, debugging, navigating the code. And all of these are the activities, if they are accessible to visually impaired person, they can easily code and do their activities. Throughout the talk, we will be talking about what are the different challenges in all of these fields, in these activities. So here is a slide which basically a kind of a wish list that an accessible IDE can have so that a visually impaired person can code easily. So these are some of the features or that we found out with our own experience, as well as we done a research paper survey in this space, the people, the research they have published. So these are some of the features that they have come with. It's the thing to be noted here that these all of these features are not implemented in every IDEs. Some of them are present in IDEs, but no, it's, again, it's not a uniform experience throughout the IDEs. So talking about these features, first one is how you access different windows and other things. So if you have a keyboard shortcut for that, it's really nice, because most of the visually impaired person use only keyboard to access their laptop. They hardly use mouse. Well, it may sound surprising, but they don't use mouse. Then, yeah, so if there are keyboard shortcuts for them, this is very easy. Also, there are indentation changes that are happening in the code, and that conveys semantic meaning to you for the code. For example, in Python, it's very crucial. So if there are some audio beeps for that, that would be very helpful. That could be another feature that IDE can include. Then there, suppose you are reading a very large code base. Now, as a sighted developer, you can fold a particular piece of a code and get a high level overview of, you know, the code, how does it work, what are the different steps involved. But because screen reader is reading all these things linearly, so what happens is that they need to read it line by line. That's very time consuming. One of the solution could be that you present this code in a form of a tree structure or hierarchical structure, where you can expand or collapse nodes that are not interesting to you and go on reading the code. And one more thing about is this bookmarking and tagging feature. So for example, you are right now working on some code and you thought, I need to see this function definition maybe. So what you can do, you can jump on that, or maybe you do it by keyword search, whatever the method. But the problem is, suppose you want to just come back to the place. But again, because you need to find out all that place, it would be good if there is some bookmarking feature that person can place before going to any other place and then come to the place in the code that he was working on. Similarly, suppose you search some keyword in your code. Now, when you are searching some keyword, you can land anywhere that keyword appears. So one thing that any person would like to know when he has appeared into the place, how does the context look like? Where am I right now? So if there is some feature that would tell you that you are at this particular function, this particular class, in this particular for loop, so that would be also helpful for visually impaired for knowing the context. There are other things as well that can be done. For example, there is this syntax error happening in the code in the video that we saw. So there could be some audio feedback that is beeping in the background. Well, hey, you did something wrong, just fix it. But yeah, right now it's not there. So you just build it and then you get to know, oh my God, I did an error. And that is something frustrating sometimes, because yeah, you get to realize it very late. Okay, so this is the feature that are up. Now we will be talking about different commonly used IDEs in the Python space and how does their accessibility look like. So first one is IDLE. It's very basic tool that comes with Python itself, but how many do you think it is accessible? Any number? Any say? It's not that much accessible. So though it has very simple interface, for example, the command line and the interactive prompt they call, also the editor where you write the code, the editor interface, even that is not accessible. Screen reader just goes silent. As simple as that. So you don't hear any audio, for this from the screen reader about the text that could be there. Coming to the Jupiter that we just heard back in the talk. So Jupiter is quite well as compared to Idle. So it has an HTML-like interface, as Jack was telling. But what happens is that all these interface, these elements are well labeled, so you get to know that what are the buttons, what are the different areas that are there for visualization and edit box, everything is there. But the main accessibility bug that appears in Jupyter is its editor interface, or where the cell where you write the code. So when you go through it by using screen reader, what happens is that you are not able to read it as multi-liner. Right now, what blind people do then, they just write their code in Notepad and then just copy paste it in the cell, because cell itself is not accessible, so they can't write it there, and then, you know, if they want to correct it and read out what they wrote, so right, that's how inefficient it is right now. Coming to the another famous IDE, Visual Studio Code, it has again very nice features. So you can jump between different windows, and these different commands are there to run the code. But again, for example, the video that you saw was in Visual Studio Code, and it was not reading you that there was a syntax error, or not telling you and giving any feedback. Okay. So it's not that the people are not doing anything in this field. So there are some approaches or some initiatives that are being taken. So I'll be going through three of them here. So one thing to note here is that these approaches could be taken at three levels. One is the screen reader level itself. Another is you make some changes in the IDE, or maybe you make some changes in the programming language itself, so it becomes more accessible. Let's see how. Scorm. Scorm is a programming language which has an evidence-oriented programming design. So what they do is that they look for their new features through research or user survey studies, where they try to find out how could I implement or design my language such that it's accessible to all the users. So they did a user study with blind people as well when they started designing this language, and they designed it in such a way that it is more user-friendly with visually impaired person. Again, the point to be noted here is that this Quorum language has, for example, for for loop, it has a syntax, let us say, repeat 10 times or something. So you can, instead of reading left pen, right pen, all those things, you can just understand it more intuitively. Similarly is an approach that is taken by Scala, whereby custom scripts are written at screen reader level, and these custom scripts read the code in more intuitive way, as you can see on the slide. So there is this Scala again has very scary syntax, to be true, but yeah, this but these scripts that are written, they read it very natural or intuitive way. For example, for this generics thing, they would say context bounded by this. For parameters, they would say parameterized by a or int and something like that, instead of reading left bracket, left paren, this, that the screen reader was doing in the video that you saw. There is a thing called Code Talk. So it's an IDE extension developed by Microsoft for community and professional edition. It has many cool features with respect to accessibility. For example, if there is some error, it will keep beeping. Well, hey, you did something wrong, just fix it. So I will not go away until you don't fix it. So that's a very cool feature. Another thing is about debugging. So debugging is very inaccessible area right now. But this is the very few approaches that people have taken. So this is one of them. So there they introduced talk points. Talk points is basically an audio debugging point, which basically reads out the value of the variables, whatever you want to see at your breakpoint. And also it tells you some audio beeps that, hey, your code passed in through this particular execution context. So by that you can see. So moving to the next part.
Yeah, hi everyone. Now we already look into the IDEs, how IDEs are accessible. Now let's look into the experience of visually impaired programmer, real experience when they do programming. So HTM conducted technical training program every year. So in that program, we run two Python courses last year. One of them when the student took programming first time, another one when they have certain experience like in C++ and Java, and they are switching in Python to use tools like web development and machine learning. So going through the different research paper and our survey and even our community feedback, we came up with these kind of findings. So first of that is the Python is very intuitive and it's quite understanding language, and people love to do different it's fun to do different stuff in Python because people got it's very engaging them, like people used to got the skills such as function, class and all that very easily. So like it's quite encouraging for the new learner. Another one, you can easily access Python by the command prompt, and command prompt is inherently very accessible. So this is again very encouraging thing, and people used to build very cool stuff in Python when they are using this as their first language. One of the major challenges that our student and community face is indentation, which is very visually appealing. Like it's good for a visual thing. You can easily see different blocks and other stuff, but it's a very painful task to debug or write a code when in an indentation fashion, because we also noticed that when the person switching from different language like C++, they have the clear indication by the left decision light, right, or something like that. So they are moving into a particular block. So this is the major challenge that our VI programmers face, and this is quite discouraging. So one of the solution that NVDA on the screen reader level implemented, what they have done is they have provide the audio cues. Like the higher you are in the indentation level, the higher the pitch of the audio cue. Another approach they took it, each line, what they do, they tell you whether your code is at 4 space or 8 space level. Yeah, so this is the approach taken by NVDA, and it's good, it's nice to people are working in this kind of approaches. So now look on to the buzzword of this era, which is data science. So I want to ask, do you guys think is data science is accessible for person with VI?
How many do you think?
Show of hands, please.
Okay, 3-4 people. Okay, quite few, and yeah, it's true. This space is very inaccessible, but yeah, so let's walk through some of the key points in this. So here, as you know, visual content is inherently inaccessible. This is the all the data science folks know that this is a diagram of the inception net by Google. So yeah, first of the thing, understanding the different architecture and the different algorithm to get hold of that is quite inaccessible. Even it took me 3 or 4 days to understand what is this architecture. Yeah, so now let's move on to a data science workflow. How is a data science workflow go as, and what are the challenges in that? So what we do in a data science workflow, first we do EDA, exploratory data analysis. So, and then we train some model, and then we have we test the model on different metrics. So yeah, this is one of an example. This is the data of different countries, their GDPs and their life expectancy and population. So I want to know that there are 9 plots which are sighted person can plot easily and can draw a very useful inference. In the first graph, you can see the Africa has a very lower life expectancy rate. And also you can plot the pair plots or the scatter plots to find the correlation between two different features. Whether in the Africa is life expectancy is related to GDP or not, you can easily do by visual thing. But as these visual graph is not accessible to a VI person, what can we do to we can route a different library or something like that, which can describe this kind of information to a VI person to pull out some statistical quantity or something like that. One other major challenge the VI person face is, suppose you are building a binary classifier, and what the people usually do, they apply some algorithms like PCA or some dimensional detection algorithms, and then they plot that data into the 2D grid and get the feel of, and they get a hold of the data, whether it is linearly separable or something like that. and then they build their model according to that. So also we can pull out some statistical quantities in that space so that we can describe this kind of information. So yeah, another major challenge, let's move to next slide. So another major challenge in this space is to visualize time series data, because there is a lot of visual information when you are playing with the time series data. Suppose we have a seasonality, we can compare the two plots very easily. So let's look some of the possible solution we can have in this space. So one of them is we can have an audio queue. So I will explain how it can work. Suppose we are making a plot of a stock price, and we have price on the y-axis and timestamp on the x-axis. So what we can do, higher the price of the stock, we can have a higher audio queue. So how it helps, suppose I listen a same kind of pitch after a time interval, I can feel, yeah, there might be a seasonality trend. And also it can help in the getting the fluctuation, like there are lot of fluctuation or there is some anomaly. So the pitch is very high or low at that point. So the audio queue help in that fashion. But audio queue has a very big problem. Suppose you want to compare two curves. Now you can't use audio queues because you can't play two audio at the same time and you can't compare using this audio queues. Yeah. So for that, and this is an open challenge problem, like we can work on it and build something cool which can solve this problem. Another thing we can do is pull out some statistical quantities, like what we do when we are designing some auto ML model. We apply some algorithms like change of point algorithm, or some we run a window and extract some important features that we can show to a VI person in some tabular or something in that form. Okay, now let's move to the next slide, that is our feature engineering. So feature engineering, what a sighted person used to do, suppose you are given with data, he can easily scroll down a particular column and see and compare even two columns, how they are correlated or how the things are changing. But VI person lose this ability because he had to navigate a table like cell by cell. So we can also build something in that space which likes to bring to, we can do it, we can do all this stuff, like I can have two columns print out by pandas or by numpy. But yeah, if can be done on the table level, that could be good if we compare two columns and draw out the inference. And also, like suppose there are some anomaly or suppose our data, that is example, the price is changing at a particular point. So like when I move to price column, what my library or at the screen reader level do, it's describe me, hey, the all of the values, most of the values in this column are zero, but at an index 255, I found a value one or something which look like an anomaly to me, like something like that we can build. So yeah, after having a feel of a data, like how my data look like, so we can easily train machine learning models, like whether my data linear, complex model according to that. Then one of the major challenges to compare our models. Suppose I have to build a model with high precision or say high recall or something like that, and I have trained my two or three different models like SVM or decision tree, something like that. What a sighted person do, he can easily plot the ROC curve and these kind of plots and have an inference, hey, if I want to have a high recall, I will do the ensemble of this method or I can choose this method. But again, this information is totally visually based, and we can also print out, like we can print out the area after a particular value of like probability, like 0.2, 0.4 in a tabular format, so that a VI person can easily access those things. So after you build some beautiful models, the things to deploy these thing on the clouds. So there are three main services right now: Amazon Web Services, Microsoft Azure, and Google Cloud. So these are accessible, but not quite good. Like some of the features are not accessible, and we should work upon this. And this come under the web accessibility. So let's go to the conclusion. So what we find?
1 minute.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So what in the conclusion, so what we find that there are three levels of accessibility, one at the screen reader level and one at the like programming language itself and one at the IDE. Like if three are well integrated, seamlessly integrated, every language can become accessible. And another conclusion is the graph data is the visualization are mostly inaccessible. So we can work something out to make those accessible. So now it's to call to action. I stem do annual hackathon where we build accessible cool products, so you can come and build accessible products along with us. Another call to action is the Jupyter thing, because that multi-layer thing, if we fix that thing, the VI community will it will help the VI community to grow faster, and people can do work seamlessly, and their productivity will increase. Okay. So yeah, we are open for the questions, and yeah, thanks very much.
So we're only going to be taking one question.
Thank you for the talk. I did not see you mention any terminal-based IDEs, and you also mentioned that command line is inherently accessible. So is there any work where you use things like Vim or IPython directly in the terminal, does it make it a little easier?
So currently, right now, the IPython itself is inaccessible. It goes silent when you open with the screen reader. Even the idle command, it goes silent. It doesn't tell you what you are typing on the what you're typing there.
Windows command.
Yeah, but the Windows command prompt that we talked is inherently accessible.
So you can use these features as well, but the main point out that we wanted to convey here is that the IDEs are important. It's not that you can do everything on terminal, and what functionality that you get on IDEs, let's be true, they are not present on in these terminal based interfaces. So we want to take advantage of that, because you see, the problem is not that blind people can't do these things. The point is about productivity and efficiency. Because they need to do it in very different ways, they need to figure out other things, and they need to do it again and again. So what we want is, can we build some solution together and then increase their productivity and efficiency?